Aloha guys. So now I'm on the way to meet a crazy insane guy. His name is Julian, and guess what he did? He crossed Taiwan from the south to the north by walking. It took him 45 days and he crossed high mountains. This is unbelievable. Once I heard the story, I was like, okay, I have to meet with him, get to know about this insane journey. Today it's his final day. He's going to Fugui Lighthouse and I'm meeting him right now somewhere in Yaminshan in the mountains. I thought the map was broken, no. So I was like trying to
text you. I stopped the tracking.
Oh, really? Hi.
Hey, nice meeting you.
Nice to meet you.
I'm so Elena. Cool.
Finally meeting you in person. Let me see your legs. Okay. You alright?
Yeah, I'm pretty good.
Good?
Yeah, we just realized it's 8 kilometers left, which is the last percent. Once I really had to carry 7 liters of water and
what?
Food, and then I think it was closer to 30 kilos.
When you heard about Julian's idea to cross Taiwan, what do you think of it?
That this man is crazy. And it's a nice idea actually, use this way to discover Taiwan.
It's an inspiration, I want to do stuff like that too.
For most of the Taiwanese people, we are always busy with our job and we don't have freedom or time to do the thing we want to do, so I'm just very curious about him.
I think it's very good and I envy him.
Really, why?
Because we don't have the boss to do it.
I met him in Hualien and he was like, oh, I work from Kenting. I was like, what?
Lou and I, we started the journey together, right? We both love mountains. It was clear that we wouldn't go at the coast. We had no idea that it's actually a thing that some people walk around the island. We only learned later. So we just thought, okay, let's try to do as many mountains as possible in between and see as many different places as possible.
So walk me through, how did you get to know about Taiwan first of all? Because a lot of people, especially from Europe, they think of Thailand.
So Flo came up with the idea to go to Taiwan. His dad was here before, and then I think in October it was announced Taiwan will open up for tourists again. So he said, okay, let's go to Taiwan. And at first I was like, nah, not really on my list. I was more like, I don't know, it was more in more adventurous countries on the first side, like Nepal, Cambodia, and so on. I think one aspect was also you don't really know how the pressure, the tension with China will end up at some point. But then he really convinced me that it's really beautiful here, and then I also met Fish Tree, who was attempting Manaslu, the mountaineer from Taiwan, and she said, you know, mountains in Taiwan are not that high, but very beautiful. And I think you will like it. And then we talked a little bit about Taiwan, and then I looked probably at two pictures and I said, oh, that's actually true.
So Flo is your friend, and where is he? How come you finished by yourself?
Well, I called him so we could finish together. We started together, we finished together. It was all extremely spontaneous. When we knew we would do this hike together, his brother already had a flight booked to Malaysia to visit him. And you know, like then he couldn't say, oh, you're coming to Malaysia, I'm not there. So it was clear from the beginning that we'd only start together.
It's getting darker.
It's getting darker, but we're also getting closer. 3.7 kilometers, oh my god!
How long did it take you to plan the route in Taiwan? Because I remember...
Until last night.
Until last night.
This initial route, the draft, we posted into several hiking groups on Facebook. And this is where all the feedback came in, and also a lot of feedback that told us this will be impossible to do.
Actually, that was my thought too when I saw your post on one of the Facebook groups. I was like, okay, those two guys are pretty crazy. They're trying to cross Taiwan like through the high mountains, and it was in winter, the coldest months. Taiwanese mountains are kind of tricky because they look solid, but a lot of times they rock slide, so like the soil is not that strong, so it just like falls.
Yeah, and earthquakes.
Yeah.
That's true, many landslides. But I knew that from many other countries, like Nepal. That was only walking over super huge landslides where we had like rocks like this falling in front of us. With kind of that in my mind, okay, I don't think it will be a lot worse than mm-hmm. this, and it wasn't. I think most of the things people told us up front, we expected.
There was a lot, some negativity, but also a lot of very, very detailed posts. Like some people really, I guess, hours to look into our route and tell us, look at this particular section, you need a different permit. Here you can't walk. And this is also why we adapted the route the whole time. And I would also say probably the people who criticized the most were also the most helpful in the end.
Oh really?
Yeah. So then we had longer discussions and private messages, and they were super responsive.
I think for too many I looked quite lost. Mm-hmm. Maybe this is also why I got so much help.
That's a good point. You just need to look closer when you're traveling.
Yeah, look as if I'm in need.
Lost and cute.
I think most people thought I'm hiking around the island. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I don't speak Mandarin, but often I got this. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh. So then I tried to learn how to say, Wo zai Taiwan, du bu ba bai gong li. They always ask, like, coast, Huayan, and so on. Uh-huh. No, Shan, mountain.
How many kilometers did you hike every day? Or how many hours did you hike every day?
Really depends a lot on the terrain. The first day we started with another friend of ours, and it was her birthday, so we had beers, we only walked 13 kilometers, we just enjoyed ourselves. The second day we hiked 18 kilometers, then we realized there are hot springs if we do another 20. Mm-hmm. So we ended up doing 38 kilometers on the second day.
Just for the hot springs?
Oh yeah, it was worth it.
Taiwan is perfect for hiking because you just hike, get in the hot spring, hike. Yeah, I love it so much too.
Yeah, no, because it really relaxes the muscles. And then if you go to Lisong hot spring, it's just already beautiful to be there.
Throughout the time, where did you stay? How did you manage your accommodation? Did you camp or?
Yeah, I think this year I stayed far more nights in the tent than in buildings. Sometimes it was also just camping in public parks next to roads.
Was it kind of awkward to camp in a public park? We tried to do it a couple times, but yeah. Then in the morning there's some people coming to exercise and they accidentally like try to get in your tent or like try to investigate who is there.
That never happened, but yeah, when I woke up in Suao at 6 I got out of the tent and there were already 3 grandpas like circling around, ni hao, in the morning. I was like, okay, good morning.
So how did you take shower throughout the whole time? I'm just curious.
Yeah, I think until reaching Taipei, I had more hot spring baths than actual showers. We did couch surfing a bit. We tried Tinder.
Did it work?
It would have worked, actually. First, it was this kind of Tinder conversation with, oh yeah, we can have a drink, but I don't know if I can host you guys. I don't know you. I know this is a very weird Tinder conversation, yeah. But maybe you've heard of couch surfing. Here's my profile. Yeah. There are like 50 references. And then she replied, oh, I'm also on couch surfing. You can stay at my place. Okay. From this Tinder conversation,
like,
oh, couch surfing, you're very welcome.
So how much left for now?
Well, I guess one? 1 kilometer left?
Oh my god. It is really 1 kilometer.
Yeah.
Don't cry.
Ah, I might cry. No, I'm just happy now. We didn't make it the easy way. So, how far do we have to go?
Technically, the lighthouse is open.
Right hand side.
You go inside.
On the right hand side?
I think all the way in front.
Whoa. Check this out.
Oh my god, what's that? What does that say?
Course complete.
Ooh! Congratulations! Woo! You made it!
Oh my god.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much for being here with me. It means a lot to me, honestly, that so many people came today. We did it! Wir sind da! Guck mal, welche alles so steht!
Ah, good job!
You made it. Give a hug. Thanks for being here. Thanks for being here.
It's okay.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Well done. Thank you.
I'm sweaty, but you have to go.
How are you feeling right now, standing at the most northern part of Taiwan?
I could do it again.
I don't know.
I mean, it's not unexpected. I had a lot of time to mentally prepare for it, but I would say I'm more sad that it's over than happy.
Really?
Yeah.
So you feel totally fine walking every single day, being tired?
I mean, now I also look forward to having a bit of rest. But in general, it's a good life. We humans are made for walking.
We used to walk 20 to 30 kilometers every day. So what I did was totally normal for people many years ago. What I like nowadays a lot is that you got to see so many details. When I went down to Roko, I could stop at any point, take a picture, because, oh, the river looks very beautiful here. If you go down by a car, you might not even see it. Plus, people will start talking to you because they see he's traveling in a different way, like huge backpack, walking on the road. They will reach out like, oh, what are you doing? They're just interested, and then you meet many people.
After 45 days, what do you think of Taiwan? What was your impression of this place before you came and after you finished your journey?
After 45 days, I'm totally in love with the country. No, honestly, like a couple of days ago, I thought I could imagine living here. Maybe not
really?
Forever, because I really like Europe, but for a while, definitely. And it sounds so cheesy, and it's true for many countries that, oh, they are so friendly, but I would really say that Taiwan puts it on the next level.
In which sense?
People not only tried to help, they were actually helpful. Mm-hmm. And also in a lot of Southeast Asian countries, I would say 90-95% of the people are nice because they are just nice. Mm. But a certain percent, just they see a white rich guy, they want my money. And in Taiwan, that's not the case. Like, no one ever wanted my money. Even when I wanted to buy a Pocari from a woman who only sold drinks, when she learned what I'm doing, she's like, oh no, I'm not accepting any
really?
Money. Yeah. Also for food. We were at the restaurant eating with them. I mean, we only had a conversation with Google Translate, but when they learned about it, they wanted to pay for us. They invited us for even more, like a beer and so on. They really wanted to invite us, and that was coming from the heart, and no one ever wanted to have money.
Yeah, it sounds very Taiwanese.
Yeah,
people
it is,
always
it
like
is.
Super welcoming.
Yeah.
Sometimes they even give you food during the hike, right?
Yeah, whole time. Also the nature, the landscapes, but you could go diving, you could go cycling, surfing, climbing, paragliding, basically all in one day.
Everything, right?
All in one day. Yeah, that's amazing.
So, thank you so much guys for watching the video and subscribe to our channel and see Julian somewhere in Taiwan.
Thanks Taiwan.
Okay, thank you guys.
Bye-bye.